We were discussing a second order op amp in a feedback loop, which of course gives you a closed loop transfer function, which is also second order. Okay. What we are trying to do is gradually increase the order of the system in the feedback loop and see what might happen to stability. Okay. In this particular case, we are looking at an A of S which has a certain DC gain and it has two poles. Okay. But of course, the motivation to do all these things is that to get a large DC gain that is required in an op amp, you have to use many stages, which means that we will have a high order system in feedback loop. Okay. So given this, what was the closed loop transfer function? What did we get? So this is always for this particular amplifier, K by 1 plus K by A of S. Okay. And that gives us K divided by 1 plus K by A naught, that is the constant term. And what is the coefficient of S? What do we get? Hmm? 1 by P1 plus 1 by P2 times K by A naught, and the coefficient of S square? K by A naught times P1, P2. Okay, you get some second order transfer function. Now, in case of a first order transfer function, you know that the response is going to be exponential. There is only one parameter, the pole, that tells you how fast the exponential decays. Okay, if you want it to settle faster, that pole must be moved to higher frequencies. In case of a second order system, you have two parameters. And P1 and P2, but it's harder to make any judgments looking at the value of P1 and P2. It's a lot easier to judge the response by computing the natural frequency and the damping factor. As the natural frequency increases, the response gets faster and faster. That is, it gets compressed in time. But exactly now, the natural response can be complicated in a second order system. That is, it can sluggishly settle to the final value. It can do it rather rapidly, or it can oscillate back and forth around the steady state value and then finally settle down. And these are characterized by values of the damping factor. What is the damping factor for critical damping? 1. Yeah. So, or equivalently, the quality factor is 2. So, to judge that, you have to renormalize this to be of this form, 1 plus S. Okay. So, what is the natural frequency omega n that you get? Square root of P1 P2 A0 by K. Actually, that's not quite correct. Yeah, because you have to, this coefficient is not 1, right? So, I think what you get is square root of P1 P2 times 1 plus A0 by K. Okay, and this is approximately equal to square root P1 P2 times A0 by K if A0 by K is large as it should be. Okay. If you go back here, you will see that this A0 by K, this is nothing but the loop gain at DC, right? The loop gain at low frequencies. That has to be large enough so that the DC gain is very accurately set to K. Okay? So we do expect A0 by K to be large, that's all I'm saying. And the damping factor zeta, how much is that? 1 by 2. into k by a naught. Is this correct? This is approximately correct, I think. Okay. I mean, again, you will get some 1 plus a naught by k like thing, which I have approximated to a naught by k. Is this okay? All of you got this, or those of you who bothered to calculate? So now, and the quality factor is nothing but 1 by 2 zeta. By the way, zeta equal to 1 corresponds to critical damping, which is the same as quality factor equal to half. Okay. So large values of quality factor mean small values of damping factor. Okay. So damping factor is usually the term, I mean, as the term means, large damping factor means it's heavily over damped and the response is sluggish, and under damping means that it can oscillate. Quality factor refers to something else. If you have an LC resonant network or a spring mass system, a high quality system means that there is no loss. There is no loss, the energy keeps oscillating between the capacitor and inductor or between the spring and mass, and it will never stop. If the damping factor is zero or the quality factor is infinity, then there is no loss at all. Okay. So the energy keeps alternating between the spring and mass or the capacitor and inductor. Okay. So it refers to something else. But anyway, in our case, we want, roughly speaking, we will say that we want quality factors not more than 1. Okay, that means damping factor not less than half. Okay, because for a damping factor of half, it will overshoot slightly and then settle down. But if you have substantially lower damping factors, then it will oscillate back and forth many times. Okay, so that's the range of damping factors we are looking for. Now, the damping factor that we do have is before going here, is the response stable? I forgot to ask this question. Is it stable? Meaning, are all the roots in the left half plane? How do you know? No, yeah. P1 and P2 are positive quantities in this. Okay. How do you tell if this is. Is this stable? Do you know? A naught is positive, P1 and P2 are positive, then is it stable? What's that? Yeah, all coefficients of for a second order polynomial, that is true. If all coefficients are positive, the roots will be in the left half plane. Okay, this is not true for higher order stuff. A third order system, for instance, you can have all positive coefficients and still have roots in the right half plane. Okay, so this is definitely stable in that sense. That is, if you excite it, the natural response will die out with time. But what we are looking for is not just stability, right? I mean, if you start something today, you don't want it to settle down tomorrow, right? You want it to settle down in some reasonable time so that you can start using it. Okay? So for us, it's also what is important is not just that it be stable. So if it is in the left half plane, it will definitely be stable. But you're also kind of interested in how far in the left half plane it is, so that it settles down quickly and cleanly. And as you know, the damping factor characterizes the second order response if this is the steady state value. For a small zeta, you get something like that. For zeta equal to 1, you may get something like that. And for zeta equal to zeta less than 1, much less than 1, you may get something of the sort. Okay. Now, just look at the expression for zeta and tell me, is it likely to be over damped, under damped, or critically damped? Yeah? What is it likely to be? Under damped. Why? Well, a naught by k is very large and this is inversely proportional to square root of that. Okay? So it looks like it will be under damped, although it will depend on the value of the poles. Okay, and Now, given that A0 by K is quite large, of course, P1 and P2 can in general be anywhere. But what is the worst case? Worst case meaning the absolute lowest damping factor that you can get. P1 equals P2, okay? So, if the two poles are on top of each other, that's the absolute worst, okay? For a given A0 by K, if the two poles can be anywhere, but if the two poles are indeed on top of each other, it will be really bad because then the damping factor will be the lowest, which means that it will ring 100 times before it settles, okay? So, this first of all is the zeta is likely to be small because A0 by K is much more than 1. Remember, this is what you are aiming for. This is the DC loop gain. That should be much higher than 1 in a negative feedback system. Otherwise, there is no point designing such a thing. Okay? And even within that, for a given A0 by K, zeta is lowest when P2 and P1 are on top of each other. Okay. Any questions about these conclusions? This, I mean, I didn't explain it, but I thought that was clear. This expression is of the form x plus 1 by x. Okay. So x increases like that, 1 by x decreases like that. Right. So the sum will do something of this sort and it will have its lowest value when x equals 1 by x, which is 1, okay, or p1 equals p2, okay. So, this sum here, the highlighted part, it has the lowest value when p1 equals p2, okay. And in fact, in that case, the damping factor is simply square root of k by a0, which is a very small number. Even if a0 by k, the DC loop gain, you want it to be very large. Let us say it has a modest value of 100. Then this will be 1/10, okay, which is quite underdamped. Is this fine? So, second order system, it will be stable in that the natural response will die out with time, but it is very likely to be underdamped. So, consequently useless. You do not want this kind of a system, okay. There are many reasons why underdamping is not good. First of all, the settling time, you may want the amplifier to settle quickly. And also, in many cases, you do not want this type of overshoot at all. So, I think all of you have used power supplies in the lab, right? So, the way power supplies are made are also with negative feedback systems because you have to set the voltage very accurately, okay? So, essentially that power supply is a negative feedback amplifier with an accurate reference. So, let us say you have to apply some voltage to the circuit, right? And the actual response does this when you turn it on. It goes beyond the, maybe this is supposed to be 1 volt and it goes to 2 volts and then comes on. And it could actually damage your circuit or have some other effects, right? So, you do not want, when you turn on the supply, if you have set it to 5 volts, you do not want it to shoot up to 8 and then come back to 5 and settle, okay? Although it settles, that is not important. When it has gone up to 5, when it has gone up to 8, it could have damaged something, okay? In many cases, you do not want this type of overshoot also. And similarly, in responses, you do not want it to go under because if this voltage becomes very small, let us say a power supply voltage, then whatever circuit you are powering with it, right, it could actually fail, okay. So, let us say you have a processor and you have a power supply. The power supply is another negative feedback system and if the voltage becomes too small, then the voltage is too small to operate the processor and the whole thing will fail, okay. First of all, there are oscillators which are not damped at all, which is what you want, okay. For an amplifier, typically you do not want severe underdamping. I mean, the damping factor of half is okay, but very small damping factor, I cannot find any use. If you want an amplifier, now there are filters, okay. If you make a band pass filter which is very narrow band, it will be by definition underdamped, okay. It will have a quality factor that is very high. So, that is different. So, in those cases, yeah, you do want underdamped. That is right, but when it changes from some level to another level, it should not go below. Obviously, when you turn it on, initially it was at 0, so it will be less. So, I am talking about let us say changing from one level to another. So, the example I gave, so let us say there is all kinds of voltage scaling that goes on in a computer or in any modern system to save power, Okay, so you reduce or increase voltages, not all the way down to zero, but when you reduce it, it shouldn't go below the target. That's the idea. Okay. No, overdamped will simply mean it will be slower, that's all. Okay, so if you reduce from here to there, it will go like that. Okay, it won't do that. It's only the underdamped response. Overshoot means, I mean, you have a starting point and the target. You have to go from starting point to the target. Overshoot means you go beyond the target. Okay, and there is another thing known as undershoot, which happens because of zeros. That is, before heading towards the target, it starts in the opposite direction. Okay, so that is, it does that. Sometimes it can do that. Okay, so I think you are all convinced now that a second order system will be stable, but that by itself is not sufficient. We also want it to be well behaved. But if you look at it, if you will design it for a large value of V0 by K, that's the point of using negative feedback. If you do that, you are guaranteed an ill behaved system, right? A severely underdamped system. So what can you do to fix it? Given that you can't fool around with V0 by K, what can you do? Yeah, what do you have to do? What is that? Poles have to be far apart from each other. So that is, we know it has a minimum value of 2. But if P1 and P2 are very different from each other, it will have a much larger value. And that will restore the damping factor to some respectable value like half or 1 or something. Okay. So the poles have to be far from each other for this system to be well behaved. Okay. So please find the ratio. Let me assume that P2 is the higher frequency pole and P1 is the lower frequency pole. Okay. And A0 by K is very large. Okay. So let's say A0 by K is very large. I don't know. Something. I mean, this is just to say that it is a very large number. Now, find P2 by P1 such that the system is critically, please do this, and in fact, you can take A0 by K tending to infinity. Well, actually, no, I don't want to do it this way. Yeah, just for a large A0 by K. Okay. Now, it's easiest if you realize that one of these will be very large, the other one will be very small. So, you can use that approximation as well. Otherwise, you will have to solve a quadratic equation, which is useless effort. So, one of these is going to be large, the other one will be small, and you can use that fact. What do you get? P2 is 4 times A0 by K times P1. Okay. So if A0 by K is 1000, P2 has to be 4000 times more than P1. So you have to situate the poles very far from each other. Okay. Now if you recall the response of the common source amplifier, what was some key feature that was there? Pole splitting. Okay, so I told you that it will actually help you, the pole splitting phenomenon, because of the capacitance across the amplifier, that is actually separating the poles, right? It's moving one pole this way, one pole that way, and that's the kind of thing you want in a negative feedback amplifier. So we will use that, but that comes later. Now, where is my favorite plot? Okay. So this plot is busy by now. But on the same plot, you plot the loop gain of the second order system when it is critically damped. Okay. Assume the same A0 by K and same P1 as this. You figure out where P2 must be so that it is critically damped and plot it on top of this. That is, this is the loop gain of the first order system, the blue curve. Okay. Now, I have a second order system. It has the same A0 and same K as the first order system. It's basically the op amp has been changed to a second order op amp. Okay, and it also has the same P1, just for comparison. Okay, so on this, you plot the Bode plot of the new loop gain of the second order system. Okay. This we discussed yesterday. What is loop gain? If the op amp's gain is A of S, what is loop gain? I break it here. I set Vi to 0. I apply a test voltage, V test, and I see what comes back. We return, and loop gain is minus V return by V test, which is simply equal to A of S by K. Okay. So if you plot the magnitude and phase for a first order system, the op amp gain is some A0 by 1 plus S by P1. And for the second order case, I'll assume that everything remains the same except for the addition of a new pole at minus P2. Okay. Now, this is not an arbitrary location. I also said that when put inside this amplifier, the critical, it should be critically damped. Okay. So, with this one, zeta has to be 1. Okay. By the way, let me also write down the expression for the loop gain. The loop gain for a first order system is A0 by K divided by 1 plus S by P1. Okay. The DC loop gain is A0 by K. This is why, I mean, you should have realized it by now that when we evaluate the DC gain of the op amp with a finite op amp gain, what is the number you get? K by 1 plus K by A0. Obviously, the DC gain is influenced by the DC value of the loop gain. So, if this DC loop gain is very large, if it goes to infinity, this will be K. Okay? It's not just the gain of the op amp or K that matters. It's the loop gain that appears directly in the expressions. We have seen this everywhere now, right? And the loop gain in the second order cases, again A0 by K divided by 1 plus S by P1, 1 plus S by P2. Okay. And for zeta equal to 1, what's the value of P2? 4 times A0 by K times P1. Okay. So with this, you should be able to sketch properly first order case starts from A0, there is some P1 here, and it rolls off at minus 20 dB per decade, and there are no more breakpoints, it will just keep going that way. Okay. So this is the first order case, and the phase again this is the phase of the loop gain, so this should be A0 by K. Okay. This is fine. This is the first order case. Now, what happens for second order? At low frequencies, it is A0 by K. The first breakpoint is still P1. I said that's the low frequency pole. By the way, what is the unity loop gain frequency? A0 by K times P1. This again we discussed yesterday. It falls down by factor A0 by K. It goes out rightwards by factor A0 by K. Now, where is the second pole in the second order case? 4 times that. So, the important thing is it occurs somewhere here. Okay. 4 times A0 by K times P1. So, it continues along And after that, it changes to minus 40 dB per decade. And similarly, the phase it will largely follow the first order case up to here, but because of the second pole, it goes to minus 180 degrees or minus pi. Okay. So now this green curve, this loop gain corresponds to a well-behaved second order system. So what can you conclude from this? Yeah, it should basically behave like more or less like a first order system. Where is it deviating? After a frequency where the loop gain falls below 1, which is what? What happens when there is when loop gain is below 1? Roughly speaking, there is no feedback, okay? So, when the significant feedback is present, it should behave like a first order system. Actually, the conclusion this way is very simple, right? Although we had to calculate these things, first order system was well behaved, second order system also will be well behaved if it looks like a first order system. What is the big deal? Okay? So, very simple. And we also saw that the absolute worst case is to have the two poles like right on top of each other. That will give you severe underdamping. Okay. So now we will elaborate on these things. Again, this is very important and very important for design of feedback systems and one of the popular ways of making a higher order system well behaved. I will come to the terminology and other things later. Okay. Now, this is not the only way to do it. Right now, there are some restrictions that we have placed. I have been considering systems only with only poles. There are no zeros. If you have zeros, there are other ways to do it. But this is one of the popular ways and works very well and so on. So, it is worthwhile learning this. And I think you will see this in control systems also. Now, one of the slight differences between the treatment you may see in control systems and here is that control systems, you ask the question whether it is stable or not. And there are very precise criteria by which you can figure it out, at least in principle. For it to be stable, the pole has to be in the left half plane. Okay. For us, it is not enough if it is stable, meaning it is not enough to just have a response that decays. It should also be well behaved, that is, it should decay quickly or in some reasonable manner. Okay. It can't ring like 1000 times before decaying. That is also a stable system, but that is a useless system. Okay. So, we will also look at not just whether it is stable, but how stable it is. Now, that is a difficult question to answer. Okay. So, that is like specifying some margin. Okay. So, how stable it is, it depends on your particular taste maybe, and the context. So, but we will come up with some criteria which you can use and also which you can easily use. Already for a second order system, calculations are quite complicated. Just to show how painful it can get, we will do the third order system. Right. So, now exactly the same circuit, the op amp is third order. Now, I dare not put three different poles. So, I will put three identical poles and see what happens. So, what you do now is the following. You evaluate the closed loop transfer function V0 by VI, where this is the op amp's transfer function. Okay. And you figure out when this V0 by VI will be, when the system will be unstable. Okay? Exactly the same amplifier. That's a good question. I mentioned it. It's the same amplifier that we use now a third order op amp for. Okay, so first evaluate V0 by VI. Then we will go from there. Calculating V0 by VI should not be difficult because, as always, it is k by 1 plus k by A of s. Okay. And expand that out. One of the ways to do it is also assume that the poles are on the imaginary axis. Okay. So that is, the poles are on the imaginary axis, it is still unstable because the natural response won't die out. It will stay at a constant magnitude. Now what happens if poles are on the imaginary axis? What does it mean? What is that? Sinusoidal response, that's correct. So what does it mean for the transfer function? The transfer function is never dead or alive, but it's the impulse response that will either blow up exponentially or something. Okay, so what is the definition of pole that you hear normally? What happens at a pole? No, the pole is where the transfer function goes to infinity, isn't it? Yes or no? Okay, so but when I had this, let's say, the magnitude response is like that, right? Isn't it? I mean, not only is it not going to infinity, it starts dropping at P1. Why is that? Pole is minus P1. Ah, exactly. So we are applying sinusoidal steady state. Actually, this corresponds to the imaginary axis of the S plane, whereas the pole is on the real axis of the S plane. So that part you know. So now you tell me what you would expect if there is a pole on the imaginary axis. Huh? Yeah, so this transfer function magnitude will go to infinity, okay? So that's what we will try to find out. Essentially, so you can use Ruth Hurwitz if you want, that's fine. Alternative, this is also useful, is to see when roots are on the j omega axis. That is, for some s equals j omega, the denominator of this should go to 0, okay? So what you do is you evaluate the denominator polynomial in terms of s, then substitute s equal to j omega and then set that equal to 0. So that will give you some constraint for omega as well as the gains. You find out what that is. You understand? What is the denominator of this, by the way? What did you get? Huh? K? K by a naught plus 3k by a naught? S 3k by a naught a square plus what's that? K by a naught s cube. Okay, so you have the denominator here. So you substitute s equal to j omega and set the denominator to 0, which is the same as setting the transfer function to infinity. Okay, so if there are poles on the imaginary axis and if you did plot the magnitude response, it will actually do something like that. Okay, it will go off to infinity. So we don't have to plot it, but just set the denominator to 0 and then that will give you some conditions, right? The denominator will have a real part and imaginary part. For the denominator to be 0, both the real part has to be 0 and the denominator part, the imaginary part has to be 0. Okay? So from that you get the constraints. Everywhere you have S, you will have S by P1, okay? So please find the constraints. What I was trying to do was the following. Find out some s equals j omega naught for which the denominator could be 0. Okay, this is a kind of cheapo thing. I mean, assuming that you didn't know how to evaluate stability using Ruth Hurwitz and so on, you can still do this. Okay, now if you tried this for the first order or second order case, you will find that for no value of any parameter will you be able to do this. Okay, the poles will never be on the imaginary axis in the first or second order cases, whereas in this one, I mean, as many of you have found out, it is possible. Okay, and how do you do it? If you substitute s equals j omega naught this will be the real part. You will get 1 plus k by a naught minus 3k by a naught omega naught by p1 square to be 0, and that will give you the imaginary part 3k by a naught, and I already factor, okay, so let me do this, j omega by p1 and then minus k by a naught times j omega by p1 times omega square by p1 square. So this will be equal to 0. So if you solve these two, what do you get? So yeah, this is omega naught, right? Omega naught. So omega naught will be square root of 3 times p1. So it looks like certainly you can have roots on the imaginary axis. But more importantly, what is the value of a naught by k for which this happens? Yeah, so a naught by k equal to 8. Now I have not proved it with this method. It turns out that if a naught by k is less than 8, the roots will be on the left half plane, and if a naught by k is more than 8, the pair of roots will be in the right half s plane. Okay, which is fine. And for a naught by k equal to 8, the roots will be on the imaginary axis. So what does this say? Can we make a useful stable third order system? Why not? Yeah, if we have to, first of all, keep it to be stable and all three poles are identical, that is three poles are at p1, then I have to limit my loop gain to 8. 8 is such a miserable number, I would rather not build the negative feedback system. Okay, and this also emphasizes the point that when the poles are on top of each other, it's the absolute worst, right? So here I took all three poles to be in the same location, and this is the worst case. In the third order case also, if you spread out the poles a little more, you can have more loop gain and so on. Okay. What do I get? Is it 1 by 8 or 8? It is 8. Yeah. So you agree with the first part, omega naught is square root 3 p1. I just substitute it here, right? So I will get 1 plus k by a naught minus 3k by a naught and omega naught by p1 square. How much is that? 3. Right? And you just solve for a naught by k, that's all. Is that okay? And it comes out correctly. So what we have concluded so far is that first order is unconditionally stable, also well behaved, and second order stuff is unconditionally stable but can be ill behaved, can be severely underdamped. But you can ensure good behavior, that is critical damping, by having the second pole beyond the unity loop gain frequency. Okay, that's the idea. So that's the picture, that's what the picture showed. This green stuff which corresponds to second order, it basically follows the first order curve to well beyond the unity loop gain frequency. That is, it can start showing its ugly second order head only when the feedback loop gain becomes very small. Okay, that's the idea. Now we will also see how to do it for third order case. Third order, I mean, first of all, if you have a higher order, system higher than second order, you can't define a single damping factor. In the third order case, you can do it for one pair of roots, not for the others. But anyway, this calculation with polynomials becomes too complicated, because the case I took now is really a toy example, right? Why would you have all three poles in the same location? That's a really unrealistic thing. Okay, so we will evaluate other criteria. We will look at the second order and we'll say that, hey, whatever worked for the second order, we'll try to do that for higher order stuff and come up with some useful criteria. And later in control systems, when you come to especially the Nyquist criterion, that is the most useful thing and the most universal, you will understand these things even better. Okay, but whatever we need for our purposes, we can get from these curves and some more things that I'll draw.